Absolutely.
Any preference? Or you
want no, it doesn't matter at all. Okay, well, everybody, welcome back to the Euphoria Lounge. We're about to start our next session, which is the social media panel session. Just want to remind everybody, if you were conflicted and didn't know which session to choose and you feel, oh my goodness, I really wanted to go to that other session, remember Simone mentioned at the start that we are videotaping all of the sessions. They will be uploaded to the website, and you'll be able to view them in the comfort of your own home. So before we actually start the social media panel and introduce all our wonderful panelists today, I wanted to show you a short social media video. It's only 2 minutes, 28 seconds. So if we could do that now. So some interesting food for thought. Interesting to think that Facebook, if it were a country, would now be the largest country in the world, larger than China, larger than India. As of first quarter of 2017, Facebook had 1.94 billion monthly users. Quite staggering. So without further ado, I'm going to ask our wonderful panelists to introduce themselves in no particular order. I'm going to start with Marta, and then we'll move along the line.
Hi, welcome to Univision. I'm Marta Catan, Vice President of News for Univision Houston.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Eric Sani Nocencio. I'm the Senior Director of Digital Media for the NFL's Houston Texans here in town.
Hello. I'm Christina Serrano. I'm a creative media specialist for Mercedes-Benz of Sugarland and McLaren Houston.
Hi, I'm Allie Danziger. I'm the president and founder of Integrate, a PR and social media agency based here in Houston.
Hi, my name is Rodolfo Sules. They call me El Chamo. I work as a talent here in Univision.
Well, thank you, everybody. So what we'll do now, I have some questions that were prepared earlier, but I also want the audience to participate. So I'm going to ask the first question, and then we'll ping-pong between myself and the audience. So my first question is to Ali. And Ali, we saw on the video that choosing whether to do social media or not is no longer an option. The real question is, how well do we do it? And there are a lot of smaller businesses and larger brands that probably are not that engaged at the moment with social media. So what would you recommend for them to do?
So it is really important to be on social media. As you just saw, all the staggering stats, everyone is on social media in one way or another. And so it's an awesome opportunity to get in front of your audience. It can be really daunting. And what I hear a lot from small business owners is that they don't want to be on social media because they're scared of the negative reviews or putting themselves out there and being vulnerable. Well, people are talking about your business whether you like it or not. They may be talking to their friends about it one-on-one. They may be talking to a big group of people about it, or they may be posting on social media about your business. So if you have a presence there, then you have a way to monitor what people are saying and the opportunity to respond and control that message. So by actually showing what's happening with your business, not just selling promotions, but actually sharing the benefits that your business offers through social media, you're controlling that message to the right audience that's there. We'll get into this, but there's so many ways to target your specific audience in a way that has never really been possible before. So you're just missing out if you're not taking advantage of those really inexpensive ways of not wasting marketing dollars and just attracting exactly the right demographic. I can keep going into a lot more detail, or...
I think Eric wants to kind of add to that, so please go ahead.
You know, I think you make a very good point, and one thing that I would add to that is there's so many social media platforms out there, so I think the fear of most people when they're first jumping in is, I've got to be in all these single places.
Right.
And I think it's more important to be good at fewer things then try to extend yourself and try to do everything all at once. Because we work with a lot of sponsors and corporate partners that maybe don't have big presences on Snapchat or some of the other things that the Texans invest a lot of time and effort in. So I think for you, understanding what your business is trying to achieve, who your customers are, what you're trying to target, and then being really good at one or two platforms, I think that's okay. I think most people jump in and we gotta be, oh, in 10 different people, we gotta hire a huge staff. Start with the basics, as she was saying, and then you know you can target and be more specific as to what you're trying to achieve. But starting small is okay. Just getting in the space is probably the best thing.
Can I add to
Absolutely.
That? And no, not just think when you're thinking about which platforms to be on, I wouldn't necessarily just focus on the one that you're the most comfortable with, but think about who your audience is and what platform they are most comfortable with, and then ingraining yourself into that platform. So Facebook is the widest reaching. It's definitely the biggest and probably the one that you're the most comfortable with. But if you have a really visually stimulating business, then Instagram may be better. And so find an intern or a volunteer or whatnot who really can understand the platform and focus on that one. Or LinkedIn, if you're more B2B.
That's a great point. Eric, I'm going to ask you the next question before we move over to the audience. You've been credited with dramatically increasing the traffic to the Houston Texans website. So how do you go about creating that passionate and invested fan base? And was social media a part of that?
I think first off, I'm getting way too much credit.
Not at all.
I'm very fortunate. Like, I don't pretend not to admit that we have a very passionate fan base already. We have a football team. You know, we talk a lot about how social media divides a lot of people, where sports is one of the few worlds where everyone can come together and root for one thing. So that's one thing that we definitely have as an advantage for us. But I think what I try to do is I got there in 2013, and the sports world is usually, I would say, 2 or 3 years behind the rest of the business world. So you're trying to, because you have to understand who your audience is. Like, our fan base is mostly older, mostly in their 50s. So we're just trying to do the basics with them when I got there, getting them on Wi-Fi, understanding the mobile website, downloading our app, things like that. But what I really tried to focus on is content. Everything that we do from the Texans, whether it's something that's sponsored or branded, we're trying to provide really good content that fans want to engage with, whether it's a great highlight video from practice, whether it's Snapchat takeovers with our players, or doing fun filters so our fans can show how much they want to follow us. For us, content has been the central hub of everything that we're doing, because then
Absolutely.
You can provide content on all these different platforms. You can either drive them back to your website if you're trying to monetize there, Or now a lot of these platforms, as we mentioned earlier, are pretty much self-sustainable websites on their own. Facebook, you can put native video in there. Same thing with Instagram stories. Snapchat, you can have a whole nother world. So for us, content has really been the driving factor in how we've tried to engage our fans with the team. And I'll be honest with you, sometimes that's really, really hard. My first year, we went 2-14, and people didn't really care what we put out that year because they were upset with the product on the field. We had a quarterback last year that struggled sometimes, and it was difficult at times to put out good content around that. But that's where we focus on is content. We feel that everything builds off that.
So content is king. Who has a question in the audience? No, don't be shy. Yes.
For 50-plus, 55-plus audience, what do you think is the next step versus Facebook? I think it's a little saturated. But what do you think will create more chatter than in the next couple of years or so, or year?
Yeah, so the question was to reach a 55-plus audience, what's the best platform? Is this on? Yes. What's the best platform? And while Facebook is saturated, I would say that Facebook is really the best platform for that audience today. And you can target to your specific audience through your Facebook post. So if you don't want to waste dollars or reach or anything on anyone under 55, then just make sure that that post is targeted or boosted to that 55 plus audience, because they're there. They're looking at pictures, they're reading articles, they're engaging more than the younger audience is on Facebook. So you have a much better chance. I say that today because it's constantly changing, and my employees, who are millennials, think that Instagram is not cool anymore because now the older generation is on Instagram, and they've moved to Insta Stories or Snapchat. So that's why I say now, because it always seems to be that, like, first it's the high school kids, and then it's the millennials, and then everyone else, and then those high school kids move on to the next thing, and so it's just this constantly evolving world on social media. So I would not be surprised if in the next year, 6 months, Instagram really becomes more of that platform to reach your 55 and up audience, as Snapchat takes more of the millennial crowd, or I hear that Snapchat's not even cool anymore and I don't even know what people are on. But so it's important to really stay up to date with those trends and look at the analytics of your posts and see what's performing well, what's not performing well. This post that 2 months ago did really, really well isn't working anymore. Drill into those analytics a little bit more and understand, oh, that's because this 55 plus audience is not really as active anymore, or maybe they are more likely to click through a link than they used to, or watch a video than they used to, et cetera.
Thank you. Thank you. So, Tina, this next question is for you. Under your direction, Mercedes-Benz of Sugarland has become the most followed Mercedes-Benz dealership in the country. Mercedes-Benz is obviously a global brand, an iconic brand. There you go. Audience appreciation, that's great. How do you get Houstonians locally to engage with the brand?
So, you know, a big question we get with social media and also representing a dealership is, I got a lot of backlash for how do you sell cars on social media? Why is that important for us? Well, for us, you know, social media is a way to build preference and trust with our audience. So we really use that as a way to, as our persona, our online reputation and our persona. We know that 90% of people who want to buy a car will read online reviews before they actually go into a dealership, and they consider about 16 dealerships online before they actually enter. They enter about 1.5 in the end. So for us, we really want to showcase, you know, we want to manage our reputation online, and as far as doing it in Houston, we have a lot of partnerships locally. We have a web series that we're doing that we specifically try to highlight local Houston talent. It's titled Hot Laps, where we showcase McLaren and Mercedes AMG vehicles. And about 4 times a year, we'll try and feature a guest along with our brand ambassador, Corey Enders, who's also a local to Sugarland, who's very important to our dealership, and he has his own following. So things like that, partnerships, partnering with influencers that are local to Houston, as well as, of course, showcasing our community and ensuring that the people that we feature in our creative are reflective of the people that we see in Houston, because we know that we live in one of the most diverse places, you know, in the world, really. So that's very important for us as far as staying relevant in Houston and growing that audience here.
Absolutely. We'll take another question from the audience. Yes. There's a microphone coming over your way.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask, do you use Spanish to in social media? Why you use social media? And do you use a different language to target different age group audiences?
Is that question to
that. Yeah? Yeah, Spanish all the time. Yes, if your demographic is a Spanish dominant, for sure. What I do is that I share stuff in Spanish and English at the same time. I just divide it with a slash, and because in my Facebook page or my Instagram page, I have people that they prefer Spanish, but they also in like the 18 to 34 demographic or 18 to 25, they're bilingual and they prefer probably seeing their stuff in English. I just slash it or I use at the beginning in parentheses something that says English below, so that way on Instagram they can, if they read it in Spanish, they can go to the English side and they can also click on where it says translate and it translates it for you. So yeah, if your audience is Spanish dominant, I would say definitely post in Spanish, but if they have both, definitely post in both. And not in different, the way I do it is that I don't do it in different posts, because I've seen social media people that have done it, like they post one thing in Spanish and then they post another thing in English, but they divide in the reach there. So I prefer just do it on one post.
I think for us, we have a Spanish language website. It's called SomosTexans.com. And then we have a Los Texas Twitter handle. And then we also have a big Facebook following that speaks Spanish. We have 300,000 fans that identify as Spanish speaking. Using the metrics that were mentioned early on Facebook, we can ascertain that. So we do is we have a Spanish language content team, which is led by a play-by-play voice, Enrique Vasquez. So he writes specific content for that audience that's in Spanish. And we push that out on those channels. And then we also do some more interactive stuff on those channels with him kind of as the lead in terms of a brand ambassador. We don't do the Spanish and English posts. We kind of do separate because there's quite a bit of difference there in terms of what our audience is. But I have seen people do that with some success. But for us, we tend to separate it because we can specify with the channels that we're using. We're not using HoustonTexans.com to push Spanish language stuff. We're using Los Texans. So we've divided it that way. But we definitely do a ton of Spanish content around the team.
For television, for television and the news industry, at least here in Houston, it depends on the platform we use. On Facebook, it's mostly Spanish, okay? But on Twitter, we do both. And obviously, we have a number of followers that are fully bilingual. Based on the most recent study, Houston Univision has a very large number of bilingual viewers watching us. So again, it depends on the platform.
Ali.
And for us, since we work with a wide variety of brands, when we see that over 10% of the audience over 10% of the audience prefer Spanish as their dominant language, and that's data that we can get both from website, from Google Analytics, and from Facebook, then we do kind of the opposite of what you're saying, where we do take the exact same content that we've posted in English and we'll post it in Spanish just targeted to that 10% or more audience that prefers Spanish so that they see that content. We then hide it from our news feed so that when we're not posting the same content twice because we don't want to have the same images and multimedia, but we do make sure that in those Spanish language posts that we do have photos that reflect that audience.
So I guess it's not one size fits all. There's different ways of doing it. Tina, do you want to comment on that?
Well, with our dealership, we do everything in-house. So right now, to be frank, it is difficult to kind of, you know, please all of our audiences that way. But we do definitely have a huge Hispanic following. And moving forward, it's something that we definitely want to put more emphasis on. In fact, Mercedes-Benz USA, we spend about 15% of our TV spot money for Hispanic TV and Spanish language TV. So it's a huge part of, you know, the Mercedes-Benz brand and as well as McLaren Houston. So moving forward, it's absolutely something that we plan to experiment with and get better on for sure.
That's great. Okay. Well, before I take another question from the audience, I'm going to ask a question of Marta, who, as you know, is our VP of News and Regional Director of Texas. So my question, Marta, is going to be, how has social media changed the way that you produce the news?
It has changed dramatically, and our viewers are no longer passive. They want to be engaged. They want to truly be part of the informational, the newscast, the information process. Therefore, we've had to change the way we produce our news. And in April, we launched a newscast that was conceived specifically for digital, and that is Noticias 45 Edición Digital Houston. It follows, it's on almost right now. It's we go live on Facebook. We are on broadcast as well, and soon hopefully on YouTube as well. And it's constant interaction with our audience throughout the entire newscast. It is presented, it is produced in a very casual, informative way. We inform the news of the days. We have the top headlines, but we also do the what's trending in social media. And I don't know if you can see it right now. I think we were going to show it. We begin transmitting or live streaming on social media, on Facebook, a little bit before we begin. So it gives the audience also a look at the behind the scenes. They love that. They love that. They comment on it. They are able to see what our anchors go through, you know, right behind the scenes. They talk to the producer and our anchors at the same time, both right before the newscast. That's why I think I can't tell right now very well. He's kind of just standing by waiting. And during the commercials, if we cannot broadcast commercials on Facebook live, we have interaction with our audience. We respond to their questions. We say hi to them. So it has changed drastically the way we produce news. We have adopted parts of what we do on Edición Digital at 11:30 to our 5 and 10 p.m. newscast as well. It has been very successful. And thanks to Facebook Live, we reach thousands of people, not only in the U.S., but also in Latin America, and it's a pretty cool way to produce news and to get the direct engagement with our viewers.
That's wonderful, and I guess you're all able to see it at the moment. We can't see the monitors from up here, but you're seeing it, which is great. Does anybody have any questions for Marta, specifically with regards to Noticias Digital?
It is local. This one is local. At 11 o'clock, we have the national Edición Digital that is produced out of Miami, and it goes out to the entire United States. It is also streamed live on Facebook and on YouTube. Immediately following the national broadcast, or the national Edición Digital, I should say, because it's not only broadcast, then we do our local newscast. It's hyper-local with what's happening in the city, what's happening in the state, and again, with what's trending in social media. And again, it's just the engagement, constant engagement, not only with viewers in Houston, but in the entire world, really. We've got viewers from Europe, from Spain, also interacting with us.
Marta was just telling me about something that had happened in Barcelona, unfortunately, yeah, another
unfortunately,
terrorist attack.
And again, that's the beauty of social media. You know, we find out what's happening in the world, and just minutes before coming in, we learned that there was a terrorist, apparent terrorist attack in Barcelona. A van ran over a number of people. So that is the beauty of social media. That's why us as broadcasters, we have to be relevant and be in tune with every social media platform. At my age, I love it. My kids are really not into social media. I don't know why, but I am. I have Snapchat, and they kind of make fun of me and everything. But that's the only way to really stay relevant and engaged with our viewers.
Thank you, Marta.
You're welcome. In terms of, No, not really. No. Unfortunately, we are not able to measure, okay, social media or Facebook right now. But I believe Nielsen is looking into it, but it's a different type of viewership. We are targeting people that are in the office right now. We are targeting people that are out, you know, having lunch, but it's not a conflict of interest.
I think we have another question.
Marta, tengo una pregunta. Ustedes miden, a partir de que lanzaron el noticiero digital, cuánto ha crecido en porcentaje promedio los seguidores, el engagement, cuántos likes han incrementado. Obviamente el engagement se mide por los likes, por las comparticiones, por la gente que estás ganando orgánicamente. ¿Cuánto ha incrementado Univision, la página local, a partir de que lanzaron el noticiero
Definitivamente,
digital?
Definitivamente, ha incrementado significativamente, específicamente en el horario de edición digital, que es el de las 11 y media de la mañana. Pero gracias a ese informativo, también se ha reflejado un incremento en las otras emisiones de noticias, que son el de las 5, el de las 10, e incluso el matutino. El matutino es un informativo que producimos aquí en Houston, pero se transmite en vivo a nivel regional en todo Texas. Pero sí, el incremento ha sido significativo y, de hecho, muchos de nuestros seguidores que nos ven en vivo durante edición digital nos piden que pasemos las otras emisiones de las 5 y de las 10 de lunes a domingo a través de esas plataformas, lo cual estamos estudiando también en este momento. Pero sí, el crecimiento ha sido definitivamente muy grande. Mira, no lo tengo ahorita y no te quiero mentir, pero porque lo voy a checar y con mucho gusto te doy ese dato. Gracias a ti.
Marta, if you don't mind, could you just give us a Reader's Digest version in English of what you just said, so that everybody else can
hear? I forgot
hear.
What I said. That's no, I'm just okay. kidding. I'm just so kidding. She was asking if after launching Edición Digital at 11:30, if we've seen an increase in the number of likes and the reach, and yes, we have seen a dramatic, significant increase, both on our 11:30 to noon newscast, and also on our 5:10 newscast Monday through Sunday. As a matter of fact, I was mentioning to her that our viewers at 5 and 10 have asked us to also stream those newscasts via Facebook Live. So we're looking into that. So yes, the increase has been dramatic. I don't know the exact percentage, but I'm going to look into that for everybody, for her specifically.
Thank you. Go ahead, Ali.
So for small businesses who are hearing that type of growth and want to replicate that, it's really interesting. So the way that Facebook's algorithm works is they decide what type of content they want to push. Today, Facebook and Instagram are competing with Snapchat. So they recognize that live video is what they need to provide their audience in order to compete with Snapchat. So they put preferential treatment in the news feed on that live video content. So if you're going to Facebook, you are more likely to see any of the pages that you follow if they have live video. And that's just Facebook trying to push a product, just like any of us try to push products that are we have low inventory of and we need to get rid of. So for any business that manages their own social media or is looking for interesting strategies, us as an agency, we are constantly right now trying to find new ways to innovatively and creatively and ways that people want to tune in, incorporate live video into Facebook, because we know that if we have a live video, that Facebook is more likely to show it to our audience than a pre-recorded video or than a still image. So yeah, it's really important to be thinking about that.
Great point. So not only is video important, but live video, very much so.
And if I may add, you know, at the local level, and again, this is happening across the nation, but at the local level, government entities, police departments, you know, they're using live video to inform, you know, the citizens of what's going on, and very specifically also to inform the news departments of upcoming press conferences or, you know, whatever. So it is quite relevant, and mm-hmm. it's very helpful for us that are in the news industry.
Yes, go ahead.
I can do that one. Content, that's the main thing, and also be interactive with when they do the Facebook Live. When I do the Facebook Live, if I reply to comments live, whatever they're saying there, you have no idea how much engagement that gets. And I have this. I started doing local stuff back in 2008 for Facebook. And then I realized that I couldn't that I was able to do like social media segments, and I started doing this like a therapeutical minute, which is basically relationships and stuff like that. And I was getting shares from all parts of the world and getting people from all parts of the world. Now I was not only a talent from Houston; I was a talent everywhere. And clients here, when they talk to Maria, when they talk to anybody else, they can. I mean, we can sell stuff in Mexico and Uruguay mm-hmm. because we have probably like 100,000 followers from those countries. And the reason why we did that is because we were sharing content that it was important to everybody. In your case, which is healthcare, I would say something that it was working fantastic with us. We had a doctor, and he was explaining things about. When people had a skin rash and can you treat that skin rash, and we were actually replying to people that it was commentating right there at the very moment, at the very second, live, you have no idea how much engagement that gives you, because what happens is that when they comment, it goes through your top stories again all the time, and if you comment live, another person, you might be answering another people's person probably. So yes, content will be the first thing, and engage and interaction will be the second, though.
Thank you, Chamo. Another question?
Hi. So I have a question about going live. So right now everyone's competing: Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. What if you are an influencer, more of a so like a micro influencer, and which one do you choose? I mean, they're all going to be great, especially if your following is kind of the same across all three boards. What's the best medium?
Sorry, I don't want to.
No, go ahead, Chamo.
We do that all the time. You have to kind of get to know your audience. In my case, Facebook is for a higher audience. I would say when I wanted to reach a younger audience, I went to Snapchat, and I thought it was fantastic. And why Snapchat? Because on Facebook, your parents are on Facebook. I don't want my mom seeing my stuff. You know, I mean, my mom was commenting on all my posts. All my videos, all my photos. I even blocked my mom for a bit, though. So I went to Snapchat because, I mean, probably the 13 to 25 demographic was there. And the content must be different, though. Something that you post on Snapchat, you don't necessarily have to share it on Facebook. I mean, I do it as a cross-promotion. Like, I post my Snapchat video sometimes, like one Snapchat video, so I posted on Facebook, so that way people can go there and see they can find a different content. But you don't have to use all the social media platforms. So let me put you an example. I'm Venezuelan. In Venezuela, they use Twitter so much because that's the way they protest against the government, though, because the media is being shut down. So now they use Twitter all the time so that way people create a debate there. Here, they don't necessarily use Twitter. I just get Twitter for information, but we don't get as much engagement in Twitter here in Latinos in the US. So that's why we use only Facebook, Instagram, and Snapchat, and we use it completely different in different platforms. So that way, I have the same follower in three platforms, though.
I would say in addition to that, like a lot of this, you're just gonna have to try. You're going to have to try those different platforms and then go back and see how they performed. Yeah. And then you'll be able to make the decision based off. Because, like, you know, he said, you know, one version, I could tell you what the Texans do, but it doesn't really apply to you because it's such a unique situation. So I think what I would do if I were you is I would just try all of them. And then after you, it's like anything, the more that you do it, you'll get a greater understanding of what the platform does, what the strengths are for it. And then you can make decisions based on how we're going to push this content. A lot of it is trial and error. A lot of us up here, you know, they may call us experts, but a lot of it is just us going out there trying over and over and over again.
There's not a manual.
And so I'm saying, so like I think you're just going to have to jump in there and you may make some mistakes, but the beautiful thing about mistakes is 24 hours they're pissed off at something else. So you're okay. And just go, and then the more you do it, the more you'll learn, and the better you'll get at understanding what you should be doing.
Okay. Now that we're talking about different content for different platforms, I have a question for Tina, for Christina. What do you guys do to do in different, how do you guys adjust your content for different platforms? And how do you guys adjust to the differences in algorithms through all social media?
So for us, Instagram has really been king. That's where, you know, a lot of our audience is, but we also get a global reach for Instagram. For Facebook, it's a lot more tailored to Houston, so we definitely have to change our content to be different for both of those platforms. For Instagram, it's less about, you know, what's going on locally here. We still include those posts, but we also need to pertain to our global audience. On Facebook, we definitely talk a lot more about, you know, local stuff that's happening. Our clients, we showcase them on Facebook. It's a more comfortable platform for them as well to see themselves on Facebook because, again, Instagram has such a large influence for us. But it's definitely important to tailor your content for every single platform because if you are just setting and forgetting something, it just does not translate well to a viewer. You have to make sure that everything works well. There's little details. Tagging is different on different platforms. Hashtags don't work on certain platforms and they do on others. It just little details that you have to be mindful of and making sure that every single platform that you use, you're using well.
Thank you.
And I think if I could just chime in, I think it's important to also definitely test the different platforms and see which content performs best on different platforms. And then once you've tested, stick with it for 30 days, you know, 6 months, whatnot, and really go after that strategy. So for instance, one of our clients on Instagram, it's very much like community feeling and we're building loyalty and we're not really focused on new customer engagement or new customer lead generation. It's more about once you already are a member of this fitness club, hang out with us on Instagram. We're gonna be sharing tips from the trainers and making it feel really organic. On Facebook, it's a lot about lead generation. So for there we're posting much more like formalized content, much prettier photos, videos that are much more professionally done. And we've made that decision and we're sticking with that type of content strategy across the different platforms for 6 months so that after 6 months, we can then really take a step back and analyze, did this work, did this not work, is this what we want to continue doing? So I think it's important to like test a lot of different things and then have a very specific strategy on each.
And consistency.
And
as
consistent,
well.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's key. Yeah. You can't just, you know, abandon something.
Yeah, consistency, yeah. That's.
And I wanted to ask, how important is storytelling? Because we're talking about content, obviously in news you're telling stories all the time, but how much should they keep that in mind? It's so easy now to create a video with your phone, right? But how important is it for it to be telling a story that furthers your mission, that furthers your message?
It's very important. Storytelling is very important. And yes, Edición Digital, the 1130 show right now, everything that we do in exteriors, outside, is with our phone or with an iPad. We don't use cameras anymore. So it's not about the video quality anymore, but it is about storytelling. That it is key to continue being, you know, a journalist in that storytelling will take you, you know, distances. So yeah, not the quality so much, but it's about the immediacy as well. So yeah, it is key.
Okay, I have another question. So Marta, you have the news to produce, which is sexy and great. Eric, you have the Texans, fabulous. Tina, you have a great iconic brand, luxury motor, Mercedes. And Chamo, you're on the air. You're a great personality. I'm gonna ask you a question. What if I happen to be in a really boring industry? Do I still need social media?
Yes.
Definitely.
In fact, you need it more.
Definitely.
And the sexy ones.
Yes. The sexy ones are so easy.
Of course, yes.
I mean, no offense, Chad. but I would say that the non-sexy ones definitely need it more, and there are ways to to make what you do interesting. You still have a business, you still have customers, so there's someone that finds you interesting, and social media versus every other marketing platform allows you to direct that message specifically to your audience. So on Facebook, for instance, by uploading your email database and having messages that are specifically targeted to the people that have already given you their email, when they're on Facebook, then you can continue selling to them and in a way that is different than how you've emailed them or and is different than how you've messaged them on your website, but what makes sense on Facebook with the content and with the storytelling and great multimedia. So yes, it is very important, even if you don't have a sexy business. And for instance, in the medical industry, I mean, that may, I don't know what you do in the medical industry, but like, it may not be sexy. One thing that we've had a lot of success with is partnering with influencers. And you kind of mentioned this, so you can maybe speak to it as well. But having other people who have the same audience as you sharing your message on your behalf. So it's the new PR, it's the new way of you getting a message to your target audience, but a micro influencer who has 150 people who follow them on Instagram, but they are incredibly loyal, may be able to spread your message better than you can or better than a more traditional media outlet can.
Yeah, prior to working with Mercedes-Benz, I did work with an agency, and one of our clients was an urgent care, and we always joke that it was a service that we need but we don't ever want to have to use ever. So it was hard for us to kind of wrap our heads around, well, how do we gain a following? How do we gain a passionate audience when this is something that people don't even want to think about? They don't want to have to think about taking their kids or taking themselves to an urgent care. So something we did was also partner with local influencers, mommy bloggers, have them show that their experience.
Testimonials, right?
Yes, absolutely. Those were huge for us, testimonials. We, you know, you're taking care of someone in the healthcare industry like that, you know, in pretty sensitive times for them. So that can, not to exploit a story, but people who are very thankful and thankful for the treatment that they had there, they will be, some of them will be willing to share that story, and you can definitely share that on your social media. I think those are very important to showcase. It goes along with storytelling. People think boring brands don't really have stories to tell, and you know, now I represent cars, and though it's sexy, you know, with Mercedes-Benz, it's an emotional experience when people buy that. It's a milestone in people's lives. And with any car, you know, it's a big choice. So to be there and to showcase how you service people in that way, and also how people at your dealership, if they come in, how they will be treated, that's a huge influencer on people's trust for your brand. So there's definitely ways to find stories, even with boring brands.
I mean, I think it's important to take the content that you have and maximize it. So just because something was shared once doesn't mean that it's gone, that that's the only time you can ever use it. But I would say like no more than 3 times a year of the same content. And that kind of feels uncomfortable to say because that feels like a lot. Yeah, I wouldn't overshare it because then people will just get sick of seeing the same messages, and you like every audience is savvy, especially on social media, and they'll see through that.
Yeah. Or another way around it is to, you know, do an ad, make it into an ad that people can see, you know, it, they see it on their feed as a sponsored ad, as opposed to when they go to your page, they see the same piece of content 4 different times, and they're like, oh, well, it's no use of me following this person because they're just kind of spamming my feed. So, yeah, turn a piece of content that you really want people to see over and over again, turn it into an ad and make that present.
I will say, though, that for one of our clients, they have a corporate behemoth, and then like we work on the more local level, and so we're restricted by the photos that we have in the multimedia, so we've been actually using the same like set of 15 stock photos for 3 years in ads with different copy and like trying to do it in different ways and like through slideshows and videos, but our audience is seeing through it, and we're just not able to be as successful as we once were because, I mean, if you've been served the same ad for 3 years, you're just so annoyed by it. even if we're giving you really great copy and promotions and all of that. So we deal with that all the time, but I would just say to kind of be weary of that.
So I have a question. I have a question about just learning experiences and maybe social media sites to avoid. I think you spoke about this earlier. Something like Reddit or, you know, things that you may not be interested in, may not be good for your brand. Do you guys have any experiences like that? Just kind of warning signs, things to avoid, mistakes made that we can learn from?
For me, I think you have to be comfortable failing because it's going to happen. You know, and I think the beauty of social media in some ways is that if you do something that doesn't go over well, you're going to know pretty quickly. So I think, again, having the fear that I'm going to do something wrong, we're all going to make mistakes, you try to limit the amount, you try to limit how big they are. Like when I make a mistake on the Texans account, or we do, it's obviously very public. So, but you're just going to have to be comfortable. It's going to happen. You're in the heat of the moment. Yeah. So, and I think the other thing I would say is, for me, I'm 36 years old. You know, you have to rely on the people that are immersed in this every day, and that's usually younger people. And sometimes that's hard for a lot of us in the room to give trust to people under 25. There's three people that work on digital for the Texans every day, our social media platforms, myself and two others. One's 25, the other one's 23. But I've shown them what I think our voice should be, how we're trying to connect with our fan, what kind of content we're looking to create. And then from that point, you've got to trust them to make the decisions, because I don't write sentences and emojis. I'm a little old for that. But other people do, and that's the way. And then we have different voices on each platforms. So I think don't be afraid to fail, and be afraid to trust in people that you normally wouldn't. That's what I would say.
I was just going to kind of add to what he was saying. Whenever you're trying to determine which platform you should be on, especially when you're thinking about communities like Reddit or Quora, just understand that you need to have access to a subject matter expert in your company in order to, you know, answer the questions and develop the right type of content that'll get the type of engagement that you're getting. Because those communities can be very beneficial depending on the type of business that you're a part of. Those are the communities where the business leaders and the high net worth individuals and the C-suite execs are. So just know that you'll need to be able to speak to a subject matter expert. But
she's right. I mean, even Messi, which is the best player in the world, has a trainer, though. Messi plays better soccer than his trainer, but his trainer can tell him exactly what he's doing wrong. Hire someone in social media in your company that helps you. Like I did that because I needed. I mean, my page was increasing so much. I went to 500,000 followers, but there was a lot of things that they were not necessarily doing the right way, though. So I started working with someone in a social media department that gave me a lot of points, a lot of stuff that I needed to do different so I can target different audiences and keep getting more reach and likes and engagement. Because at the end of the day, of course, if you're a Texans, you're gonna get thousands and thousands of likes, but at the end of the game, it's true. I mean, it's a huge football team, though. But if you just start, like I said, a regular person, I wouldn't say that the likes are the highest thing. I would say the engagement, though. I've seen, and she was mentioning it about the fitness girls, and I mean, you see all those girls, 9 million followers, and whatever they post, they can probably promote carpets, and the people have 9 million comments about how the body looks. The non-sexy ones probably have like 1,000 followers, but if the content is really good and the engagement sometimes goes higher than those 1,000 followers. So yeah, definitely hire someone.
I do want to say from a local, smaller business level, because I know a lot of people, you know, it's easy to say hire somebody, but we have to convince people to hire people at the end of the day, and we have to fit that into our budgets. A lot of times we do have, you know, beacons within our own employees that can help with social media. We really, like, speak to your employees. I mean, so many of us in our daily lives, we use social media every day. There's a lot of people, you know, within your own company that can help as well. And, you know, use those people, reward those people, have them teach you, teach each other. It is very important to also just look within and kind of grow. Doing that, taking those small steps and then showing the value of it can then lead you to then, you know, start hiring a real department or a real specialist and then a department and then more. So, yeah, start small. Look for beacons in your own employees.
Okay, time flies when we're having fun. So we have probably time for two more questions. Yes.
I have a question here. Most of the comments and questions you've made so far point in the direction of organizations engaging with their consumers or customers. What about internally? What kind of experience do you guys have, if any, in terms of using social media to facilitate change, organizational change or evolution inside organizations, for the most part, large organizations such as Walmart and the like?
I was just going to say, for us, we have something, Texans Care is, so our president is really big. We have a mission statement with the Texans, and one of the things that's key for us is do great things for Houston. So what we kind of internalize and also use externally through our community events is a hashtag that we call Texans Care. So we have a volunteer system set up within the Texans where you go out and you can, you know, the most hours, and you know, it's like kind of a competition, and we use that everywhere we go. We've got shirts that say Texans Care, and it carries over, and what we found is it's allowed us to launch even more in the community because people see us doing it. We have something called Texans Care Volunteer Day that happens in May every year where we go around the entire city, 8 different locations, and we have fans come out and volunteer in the city. So that actually all started internally. It was just something that we did. You know, we wanted to show that we cared about the community that we lived in. We were more than just a football team, and we wanted to kind of provide a lead in that area. And it actually turned into something that the community bought into. So maybe that's not an exact example, but that's something that we started social media-wise. Like, how can we capitalize on this goal of doing great things for Houston? And it evolved into this huge platform that we now use with our community, with our fans, with our players, and within the organization.
Ellie? We work with the Houstonian Club, so they're a pretty exclusive country club, and they have no interest on social media to add new members. Like, that's just not what their goals are. Their goals are to keep their current members loyal. And so we have, yes, a public-facing social media presence, but really what we're tasked with is private Facebook groups. And so we created and manage 15 different private Facebook groups within the club. And so the tennis players like to talk to the tennis players, the yogis like to talk to the yogis, the swimmers like to talk to the swimmers, and we set up these internal communication, essentially, among the members, where the staff that are in those different subsets kind of manage it on a day-to-day basis, but the members are really engaged among themselves and with that individual staff. And so it's not really internal communications, but it's a way that, since we set this up 3 years ago, we've seen the loyalty increase so much because the members have a place to go on social media to communicate among themselves. And it's not an intranet, it's a place that they're already going. So we didn't have to build something like, oh, go to HoustonianClubMember.com. They're already on Facebook, and they can see the essentially internal comms in a place where they already are. And it's been really successful.
Great example. Last question.
Okay, sales and social media. I'd like to know your stance on, we use social media for awareness, for conversion, for loyalty. We have a lot of clients that would like us to use social media for hard sales. And maybe, Christina, that might be a question for you, since you have something to sale per se, or maybe for Ali, if you have some of your clients, because maybe ticket sales at the Texans might be easy, but selling a car maybe on social media is not.
We're just hating on you. So for cars, especially in the car business, I mean, we're so used to dealing with GMs and everybody who's just all about, you know, sales, sell me the car, you know, sell the car, do this, push this offer. With us, we've definitely had to just kind of really have a firm stance on that and just say, you know, this is not the medium to hard sell. It's the, you know, we want to communicate with people. We want to be able to not talk at them, but talk with them and enjoy these, you know, experiences with them and be fans of the brand just like they are. So for social media, we do showcase our inventory. It's important for us to show, you know, videos, walk-arounds of the car, things like that, but we try not to hard sell it. It's more from an appreciation standpoint and from a fan standpoint within the brand, and, you know, just kind of allowing that space for people to admire or even criticize if they have, you know, a criticism about the design of the car, something like that, and just be open to that as opposed to a hard sell. But again, it's for us, it is really about awareness and building trust and preference with people, and we do know that that translates to sales. So at the end of the day, it's a walk around, it's a roundabout way of doing it, but it is sales at the end of the day.
Yeah, we say that on social media, there's really three different things that you can do. You can build your brand, awareness, you can establish loyalty, and I do think there's a platform for selling, so you can build leads. And they all build upon each other, so one can't happen without the other two, and they're all so important. The benefit of social media is that you can track everything. So if you have something to buy online, then you can see exactly how many sales came from that Facebook ad. And for me as an agency, there is just nothing sweeter than, you know, saying, here's how much money you spent on this ad, and here's exactly not just the amount of traffic that we sent to your website, but exactly how many widgets you sold because of this ad. Even if they saw the ad, they left, and then they came back 3 months later, we exactly have that data, which is just, it's magic in the agency world, or really any world, but from an agency standpoint, it's so beneficial. So I wouldn't say that there's not a place for sales, but you just have to message it in a way so that you're kind of tricking the consumer so they don't know that they're being sold to, and they're so engaged with the content that you've provided that they feel compelled to click through to get more information, and then they end up buying it.
No, I was going to say that you mentioned get an influencer. That helps a lot to talk about your product. Like last week, we did something for a dental studio, though, and they were doing a whitening on myself, though. And it was the doctor and I was just telling, oh, my God, my teeth are going to be fantastic. It's going to be great. They packed the place the next weekend on appointments because everybody wanted to do a whitening, and something that it was helping them, too. Is that they had like a kind of like a customer service. I mean, on Facebook, they were replying to all the comments that they were leaving on my Facebook Live we did, saying like, yeah, we can help you. Yeah, the whitening, hey, let me give you a better deal. Yes, and they were creating a lot of leads. I've been doing an endorsement for dealerships for the past 6 years. And something that it was working fantastic for them is the GM was replying to all the comments that we were getting on the organic videos that we were doing for them. And we were actually doing funny stuff, not necessarily promoting it that straight. But this guy, the GM, he was replying from his page. He hired someone to run his page. He wasn't doing himself. But he was replying with joke stuff and whatever question that they were asking him, like, hey, how many miles that car has? Oh, it has this amount of miles. And he was creating so many leads that he was selling from 30 to 50 cars per month only through Facebook, though. So, yeah, it does work.
And I think we're all saying the same thing, and Chiki mentioned it earlier. Content is king. So if you provide your audience with something that is worthwhile, that is good content, that is humorous, that it's interesting, you get that engagement. So thank you so much to all our panelists. Okay, so before we wrap up, because you've all been so wonderful, we have a couple of door prizes that we want to give away. And if I could ask Andrea to step up and help me give these away. And I'm really asking her to step up and help me for two different reasons. I want everybody to give her a round of applause. She's been instrumental in putting this together. I could not have done it without her. So thank you, Andrea. What are we going to give away first?
So first, let's do the Chromecast audio.
Okay, so we have the Chromecast audio, and we're going to ask one of our panelists to pull the lucky winner. Patricio?
Patricio, te ganaste algo.
Perfecto.
So much better,
you own something, come here.
Okay, so our next prize is for the Apple TV.
Nice.
Yay, who's gonna get that?
Yeah.
Usted se lo quiere ganar, señora Marta, ¿no? Yo, vaya. It's my right hand, which is innocent, so. Senior Manager, Toyota, Miles Rose.
Oh, Miles, step on
Miles
up.
Miles Rose.
Yay. Miles was one of our speakers, but he's not, has he left? He's left. Okay, well, I'll give it to Felipe. Oh, is it good? Don't cut yourself. Okay, Felipe, everybody. This is for you. Do not. Okay, and our last prize is the Apple Watch. Do not cut yourselves.
Auxi Lazo Fuentes.
Auxi, I saw you earlier today, so we will keep it for you. Oh, perfect. Then you can claim it. Okay, we trust you. Okay, so finally, I just want to thank all of our speakers. Thank you, Chiki. You are absolutely wonderful. Thank you for coming down from New York. I want to thank the speakers in the breakout groups, Daniel Chen, Miles Rose, and Stephanie Masamaro, and Jared that hosted the session here in the Euphoria Lounge. Thank you, obviously, to our panelists, and thank you to all of you for coming here. If you have questions, if you require more information, please feel free to reach out to your account executives. They'll be happy to help you. And have a great rest of the day, and thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.